Finally, the setting is working. Okay, fine. Sorry, everyone. It took me some time to make the adjustment. Okay, let me see if I can share the screen. Then, yeah, hopefully it should work. Are you able to see this screen? Could you just confirm if it is visible to you people?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine. Thank you. So let us start with the electronic measurement laboratory, and today's topic is strain gauge. So we have very few students, but let us honor those people who came here, and that is okay. We have 1, 2, 3, 4 students, right? No problem. All of you are there. Number 17, are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, number 23?
Yes, ma'am.
Number 18?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so we begin, right? And I regret the inconvenience caused. I had to take some time to make the settings possible. Fine, let's continue. Let's have a look at the strain gauge part, right? Now, basically, what is a strain gauge? You know, generally, it finds application when we want to measure the forces acting on a device, right? So we today try to plot the characteristics of the strain gauge, and we try to understand the effect of various parameters on the strain gauge performance, right? So what parameters affect it and how it will make it work. So the first is, sir has put up a pretest over here. Ratio of stress upon strain, right? So ratio of stress and strain is known as, anyone, any idea what is stress upon strain? You can take support from net and you can learn it and then reply. That's okay, because you are presently in the learning phase. So we'll be waiting for your reply. Ratio of stress upon strain is known as the questions are all in front of you, right? All the three questions are in front of you.
Modulus of elasticity.
Okay, one answer is modulus of elasticity. Anyone else? Don't worry, we'll wait for your answer. You can search and find it out. Anyone else, any other answer? Or all of you agree to the same answer? That is modulus of elasticity is the correct answer according to all of you?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So what exactly does the modulus of elasticity tell us? We probably have learned about it, right? We know what is modulus of elasticity. It gives us an estimate about, okay, let us, before trying to know about the modulus of elasticity, let us know what is the expression for stress. What do we understand by stress and what do we understand by strain? What is the difference between stress and strain? Generally, people, you know, correlate this word and they use it interchanged, right? But it cannot be interchanged. They are two different words. They have two different meanings. So if anyone of you are is reading about it, can you distinguish between stress and strain so that we can understand what is the difference between them? In fact, the third question itself says stress can be defined as some ratio they have given. What about strain? Let me tell you about strain. What is strain basically? It is generally associated in this case, right? In the case of a strain gauge, to be more precise, it is generally associated with the elongation or compression in the size of the wire, and it is generally given by delta L divided by L. That means whatever was the initial length is L, and delta L is the change in the length, right? So strain is given by the ratio of delta L to L. L is the original length, delta L is the change in length of the wire. Basically, a wire is used in order to guess the stress or the forces developed over a device, right? So with that device itself is known as a strain gauge sensor. Now coming to stress, what exactly is stress? If someone has read about it, you can share.
Measurement of force put on an object.
Okay, that's fine. Force of over object, fine. Anything more specific? Because this will, you know, this will have to define. We intend to perform this experiment. Let's wait. Someone else may give us an answer, another answer.
Force acting on unit area.
Yeah, that is a better better definition. Force of acting upon unit area. Anyone else? Number 23 and 18, if you want. Okay, so should I give you the definition? The definition says stress is equals to force upon unit area, right? So basically it is kind of the in terms of expressed in terms of pressure kind of units, right? So we have stress and strain. These are our two two units, and we are trying to link them using the modulus of elasticity. But there is something known as Young's modulus, right? This also probably have learnt about maybe in modulus of elasticity or maybe in other study. Does anyone recall what does Young's modulus represent? Then we have two more questions related to it. Young's modulus basically is based upon the name of the scientist, right? Young was the name of the scientist who worked upon it. Anyone else? Any other inputs? Fine. So Young's modulus, let us see. sharing a different screen with you. That is the reason I switched the screen. See, this is what is Young's modulus. I hope you can see my screen right now, right? So this is Young's modulus. Basically, Young's modulus always correlates stress on the y-axis to strain on the x-axis, right? So if this is strain, that means the elongation or compression that is taking place in the length of the wire under the effect of this stress. Stress is generally indicated by sigma and strain is generally indicated by epsilon, right? These are the correct units for representing these values in all textbooks that you will refer, right? I'm not talking about your specific books, but if it's a standard state textbook, it tends to follow this same protocol, right? Okay, so what it says is that, it says that the Young's modulus is basically a slope. So if I take delta y divided by delta x, whatever I'll be getting is the value known as Young's modulus. Now rise by run. What is meant by rise by run? This is rise and this is run. Okay, if you take any step, any staircase also, we know rise is the vertical movement that you have and run is the horizontal distance that you have. So even in your house steps that you have a run and a rise, and the same is valid for any other graph also. So Young's modulus is the ratio of delta y divided by delta x. Here y is equals to stress and x is equals to strain. So under the effect of variation in strain, how much stress is acting over it, right? There are two other parameters written over here. So they are basically strain hardening and necking. That means if a device fails, it gets fractured. Before getting fractured, it is hardened and then necking happens. That is the threshold point beyond which it cannot operate and it breaks down beyond this, right? So that we say it is a fracture. Another image that can show this kind of a thing. This Young's modulus is equals to stress by strain. And this much is the modulus of resilience. Number 17, your mic is on. Yeah, thank you. Okay, so this is what, let me go back to my screen again. So this is what about the Young's modulus, right? Going back to the PPT, yeah, I'll have to change the screen again. Just a minute. So similarly, there are two more questions. You can take them up. The basic types of stress to which material can be subjected are compressive strength, shear stress, and tensile stress, right? So these are the different categories. You'll have to understand what is compression, what is tensile, what is shearing stress, and so on. And the weighing balance works on the principle of comparing forces, moments, acceleration, right? So we all know that it is forces. These few examples, you can take it on your own. We move ahead with the basic characterization. The test solutions, sir, has been fine enough, you know, good enough to share the solutions also with you. So you can actually go back and compare them, right? So he says first one is B, modulus of elasticity. Second one is stiffness. B again. Third one he says is C, objects internal resisting. And A. So compression, shear, tensile, and forces, right? So these are the solutions also given to you. You can check it and understand it. What exactly is stress, right? So as I said, it is a pressure kind of unit. So it is given by force upon area. So force is given in newtons and area in meter square. So the unit turns out to be newton per meter square, or we say it is Pascal, right? Pascal is the name for this kind of unit. And again, it was given by the scientist Pascal, right? So the unit itself is called with his surname. Okay, now if the direction of the external force is vertical to the cross-sectional area, the stress is called vertical stress, right? And generally we do try to work upon vertical stress, but remember, once I put a strain gauge, let us say inside a beam or maybe at the side of a beam, columnar beam that we have in our constructions, right? So they find maximum application there only, right? There are other applications also, but mostly they are used at the construction processes, right? In that case, it is quite possible that not only vertical stress, there could be stress coming from different angles also. So basically the answer we get is a combination of stress or forces acting not only from the vertical direction but also from different other angular directions also, right? So this is stress, what it is, and each material has a certain ratio of lateral strain to longitudinal strain, and this ratio is given by Poisson's ratio, right? Now what is meant by lateral strain and longitudinal strain? I am not sure whether sir has explained this thing or not, or let me just go through it once. Okay. Okay, then let me explain you what exactly it is so that you can understand, right? You all have seen, let me see if I can get on net, if I can get some help for that. Basically, lateral strain will come into the picture for a wire-like structure, right? So let me explain it with some diagrams if it is possible. Yes. Okay, fine. It is possible to show you here with the help of some examples. So I'll have to switch the window again. So yeah, now it is selected. You can see this is lateral strain versus longitudinal strain. So what they have done is they have taken a balloon like structure, something that is elastic, and you can understand it nicely, but actually this is valid even for heavy metals also. This kind of setup is working, right? It is not only valid for loose materials like balloon and all, it is also valid for stiff materials like metal rods, columns and all. So if I am pulling it this way, you can see this green colored arrows that is pulling the blue colored substance on both the sides, right? On the right side and the left hand side. So we call it the longitudinal strain, and there is an axis here, that's the middle axis here. Across that axis it is pulled along, right? So that is the longitudinal strain. And the lateral strain means this is getting reduced. So initially, if this is released, then you know this dotted line will be its actual periphery. Now, if you can see this properly, let me see if can I expand this diagram so that you can see it. See, civil engineering. It finds maximum application in civil engineering. It's not visible. Can I see this itself? Maybe this one. It enlarged so that I can show you what. The diagram is so small. View image information. This is somewhere where I can expand and show you this thing. Okay, I think this can help you a little bit in understanding it. This can help you in understanding it a little bit, right? So initially, if I take a rectangular slab, the length is L and the breadth is B. And under the effect of this forces, this kind of tensile forces, the length has elongated. It has become L plus delta L. And the breadth has also undergone a transition. It has now become delta B. You can see that initially it was a bit larger. B was a bit larger, and now delta B has reduced, right? This has become smaller. Similarly, this example can also show you, right? This is also one more example, longitudinal strain and lateral strain. So this is what, and this is the axis, right? This is the axis, but on the basis of which this decision is taken, right? So this is what is known as lateral strain, longitudinal strain, and Poisson's ratio is the ratio of these two values, right? And it is equally valid, as I said, it is equally valid for structures, solid structures, mechanical structures, civil structures also, right? So this is for the strain and stress part. Let me show you one more structure where it is exactly showing this thing. I think I lost the image. Yeah, see, this is the structure that I wanted to show you. Right, so this is actually what is happening in the case of a physical structure, right? Civil structure that is there. And that is why it finds maximum application. There are also applications in the electrical and electronics domain using strain gauge. Okay, so this is what is happening. Now, going back to our PPT again. PPT. Okay, fine. Hopefully, yes. This is what is the Poisson's ratio. It will give me delta E on the transverse axis and delta E on the axial axis, right? I hope you understand what is transverse and axial now. Axial is around the direction of the middle axis, and transverse is opposite to it. 90 degree to it is the transverse axis, right? So you can now read through this and understand. I suggest you read it. I hope it is visible. Yes, it is visible. So you can just read this thing and understand what is Poisson's ratio, because without understanding Poisson's ratio, you'll not be able to understand the later part of this explanation that is going to follow from slide number 13 onwards. So kindly just read it. I'll get back to you. So with this, we proceed with the next part. As you can see, this is what a strain gauge looks like, right? So basically, there are two connecting pads here that can actually, they are actually glued. This black portions that you see, they're actually glued to this yellow surface. And it is this length of wire, you can see this zigzag pattern length of wire that is free, right? This is again glued, this ends are glued, this ends are glued. But then rest of it is free so that it can take the effect of the compression as well as the tensile forces acting on it, right? So what exactly is a strain gauge? It is a sensor whose resistance varies with applied force. So what happens is that if I apply a force either in this direction or in this direction, right to left or left to right, what will happen is that the length of the wire will change. And depending upon the length of the wire change, we know that there will be significant change in the length of the wire. And if I try to put a force from here or here, top or bottom, what will happen is that there will be very small change taking place in the axial direction, opposite axial direction, that is transverse direction. So this, if I'm using the present strain gauge as a as a sensor for testing against forces acting on it, then I should align it in this direction only if the forces are in this direction. Supposing the forces are in this direction, then I should rotate this by 90 degree and then use it. Okay. Why? Because significant change can be seen in length, but very less change is seen in the transverse direction. So basically, we try to, and what is the change is that if length changes, if length, suppose length gets elongated, right? Suppose it is tensile forces, so it will pull this kind of a structure, the length will elongate, we will have L plus delta L as the new length, right? So what is happening is that if you remember the equation for R is equals to resistance given by R is equals to rho into small L divided by area A. Right. Suppose you remember this equation. We know R is equals to rho. Rho is a constant. Length will change. A is equals to area depends upon pi r square. Right. So if you see the cross section of a cylindrical wire, the cross section is always circular. So area will be pi r square. Now what is this R? The R is the transverse length of that wire. If there is forces acting on it, this diameter would also change. So you will have a reduced A and a larger L. In that case, you then get what is known as a different value of R under the effect of forces and without forces, right? So there are two different kind of situation. One is without any force, the second one is with the effect of force. The value of resistance offered by this wire length will change, and it is this change in resistance which will be proportional to the force applied on this entire system. Okay, so if you look at the strain gauge, it is a sensor whose resistance varies with applied force. It converts force, pressure, tension, weight, etc. So this is where they find their application. They find their application in force, pressure, tension, and weight. Right? So for weight measurement also strain gauge is used. Into a change in electrical resistance, which can then be measured. The electrical force, external forces, the experimental stress analysis, in experimental stress analysis, this feature is widely used. When external forces are applied to a stationary object, these are the results. Stress and strain are the results, and defined as displacement and deformation. Yeah, this I have already explained you. I can skip this part. Strain could be tensile strain or compressive strain. Special transducers can be designed for measurement of forces or other derived quantities like moments, pressure, accelerations, etc. Types of strain gauges based on principle of working. Mechanical. Two separate plastic layers. Bottom layer has a ruled scale on it, and the top layer has a red arrow or pointer, right? So one layer is glued to one side of the crack, and the other layer is So for mechanical kind of deformation that is taking place, we use the strain gauge in a specific manner. So what we do is that the bottom layer is glued to one material, and the second layer, top layer, has an arrow or a pointer on it. And whenever the crack expands, what will happen is that the layers slide very slowly across each other, and the pointer will indicate how much has been the deformation, right? The red crosshairs move on the scale as the crack widens. So this kind of mechanical sensor or strain gauge has got a good application. Types of strain gauge based on working principle, right? So electrical, most common is the thin rectangular shaped strips of foil with maze-like wiring, right? Maze-like wiring is something like this we saw here. This is a maze-like wiring on them, leading to a couple of electrical cables, right? When the material is strained, the foil strip is very slightly bent out of shape, and the maze-like wires are either pulled apart so that their wires are stretched, or pushed together so that the wires are, crumbled together, right? All of them coming together. So changing the width of a metal wire changes its electrical resistance. This change in resistance is proportional to the stress applied. And if the forces involved are small, the deformation is elastic, and the strain gauge eventually returns to its original shape. So what is critical in this case is that if it goes beyond a specific level, it goes into inelastic mode, right? Inelastic mode, that means it is not able to get back its original form and shape that it was initially. So that it has undergone necking, and once necking happens, it will not be able to come back to its original position. So that is why it is related to the elasticity of the material, right? the types of strain gauges based on the principle of working. So we have the piezoelectric devices, substances like quartz crystals and all. They are natural strain gauges, right? They have their tendency to behave as a natural strain gauge. When pushed and pulled, they generate tiny electrical voltages between their opposite forces. And this is known as piezoelectricity. We have learned about this. Most of us might be knowing about them. And by measuring the voltage from a piezoelectric sensor, we can easily calculate the strain. And piezoelectric strain gauges are the most sensitive and reliable devices. They are very minute. First thing, they are small in size and dimension. But the fact is that they are very, very sensitive. Even if there is a small change, it can detect that also. A strain gauge takes advantage of the physical property of electrical conductance, and it does not depend upon the electrical conductivity alone. It also depends upon the conductor's geometry. As I said, we assumed a cylindrical wire. So a cylindrical wire, if I try to take its cross-section, it will be circular, and accordingly it is managed, right? When an electrical conductor is stretched within the limits of its elasticity such that it does not break or permanently deform, it will become narrower and longer. Similarly, when it is compressed, it will broaden and shorten. Just the same thing that I have explained to you. If I try to pull it apart, it will become longer, and from the transverse direction, it will become narrower. If I compress it, it will broaden on the transverse direction, and on the axial direction, it will shorten. Right? So the change in the resistance is due to variation in the length and cross-sectional area of the gauge wire. The same thing that I have explained to you, taking the images from the net. Exactly the same things that are shared here. But since the image is not visible to you, probably it would have been difficult for you to visualize. You already saw the image before, so I hope it is now understood by you. If at this point of time, if you have any query, you can tell me. I can show you the images again. Let me show it to you. I did not delete them. Hopefully they are there, so you should be able to see it again. I have kept the image as it is. So if you wish, you can see this images again. What it says is now understood to you. So depending upon the type of stress and strain, depending upon the type of which forces you have applied, you can actually have a look in the lateral strain and the longitudinal strain. This was again the thing that we had referred to. Trying to share as many images I am getting relevant to it. In fact, right now this numbers may not be very very convincing to you, but at least you can understand with the help of this rectangular structure that what is happening, right? And what is it that I am trying to tell you, right? One more thing that I wanted you to understand is that, let me see if I can get it. Okay, I hope the same screen is visible to you, right? You can make out what I meant by no load condition and loaded condition, okay? So just have a look at it. This is how loaded and no loaded condition happens. Basically, I have kept an ammeter here, and this is as good as a wire, right? Having resistance R, and R is equals to rho into L by A, the same equation that I had used, right? Ohm's law says I is equals to V by R. So no load and the substrate as it is, and this is in loaded condition. There is a force acting on it. This red colored arrow is the force acting on it, right? And you can understand that there will be change, variation in the value of resistance. You can see this resistance, length of the wire was this much. this length has now expanded, there has been delta R change, right? And you will be able to get a current I which is inversely proportional to the force acting over it, right? And this is this image that you are looking at is from NASA's site, right? So I just came across this image and I thought I could relate it to you more better than what is given in the slides. One more image, see, this is a what we call a cantilever beam, right? It's a civil structure. So there is a strain gauge that is placed here. Yeah, there is a specific thing that you will learn maybe later on in the PPT itself. This strain gauge is because they are related to the resistance, right? What happened? Okay, let me show a different image. As they are related to resistance, we do not use it individually. We always use it in a four-arm bridge, right? A four-arm bridge means generally, if you are aware, there is something known as the Wheatstone bridge, if at all you have heard the name, right? So that's an expansion of your regular full wave bridge rectifier circuit, right? You have four diodes in a full wave bridge rectifier circuit. Instead of four diodes, we now have four resistances, and one of them is the strain gauge, the rest three are resistors. And the purpose of using it in a bridge structure is that we know that this voltmeter will be showing me zero reading when this two, right, this into this is equals to this into this. So it's a cross, when the cross, you take the cross multiplication of this, it will turn out to be zero. The voltage reading has to be zero. But if there is a force acting on it, you can see this beam has now bent. Initially it was a straight beam, right? It is a straight beam. If it's a straight beam, then the forces acting on it is zero and there will won't be any changes in its resistance values. But even if a little change happens here, it will be reflected as a good amount of voltage at the voltmeter that is located here, right? And in order to make it possible, one strain gauge is also sufficient here, but in order to make sure that everything works properly, people also put another strain gauge on the opposite direction. So one strain gauge here and one strain gauge here. So if this is expanding, this definitely has to compress. This is the logic used in order to make sure that this will work, right? So this is a bridge that is balanced. We say balanced if it is V is equal to zero, and unbalanced because V is not equal to zero. We could be positive or negative depending upon how you have configured it, right? So see, this is the original condition, the strain gauge as it is, and this is the condition under the effect of a force that is downwards in direction, right? So this is how it looks like. This is a complete diagram, the first condition and the second condition both shown here, right? So if at this point of time you believe there is a query, you can ask me, because this is what a strain gauge is basically used for. No queries. So should I assume that you have been able to understand? Then I'll proceed with the PPT ahead. We are running a little bit late. It's 11:30.
Okay, fine. Let me change the screen in that case. I'll be now proceeding with the PPTs. Hopefully you should be able to understand the rest of the part. Okay, so this is electrical strain gauge, the gauge factor. Gauge factor is given by delta divided by Rg divided by sigma. Rg is the resistance of the undeformed gauge, right? Not reformed gauge, undeformed. And delta R is the change in the resistance caused by the strain, where sigma is the strain, right? So this is the equation for gauge factor. Effect of temperature, we all know that resistance changes if under the effect of temperature there is a change in the resistance value also. So definitely this will cause different variation. Arrangement, yes. See, this is what I was talking about. This is a quarter bridge. Rest, all three are resistors. The only one is strain gauge, right?
So that is stressed or unstressed condition, whatever it may be. Here is where we find out the voltage. So it is stress, strain converted to voltage. This kind of a conversion is taking place, and hence we call this is a strain gauge as a sensor. So if I increase the number of strain gauges, suppose I put it in this way, then it is a half bridge strain gauge, right? So one here, they'll balance off each other, And then we have another structure where I'll put all four of them as strain gauges. Instead of putting resistor here, resistor here, resistor here, I put all of them as strain gauges. So even if there is any kind of forces acting from any direction, it will be able to generate a voltage corresponding to it, right? So these are the arrangements. So in quarter bridge, the strain gauge is connected in one arm. In half bridge, it is connected between two active gauges, and in this arrangement, two acts in tensile while the other two are compression. With the help of this type of arrangement, temperature compensation is also achieved. When possible, the full bridge configuration is the best to use. As I said, it will be able to check for changes in all direction, from all direction, right? It is true not only because it is more sensitive than the others, but because it is linear while the others are not. So quarter bridge and half bridge circuits provide an output that is imbalanced signal that is only approximately proportional to applied strain gauge forces, right? Linearity or proportionality of this bridge circuits is best when the amount of resistance change due to applied force is very small compared to the nominal resistance of the gauge, right? So with a full wave bridge, however, the output voltage is directly proportional to applied force without any approximation, right? So let us now go to the VLAB link and execute it. Let me generate. Okay, I hope your the screen is now visible to you. So basically, it is the characterization of the strain gauge sensor. Yeah. So let us see the prerequisite. What do we mean by stress and strain? We have seen all this. Right? These are the four types. Two-wire, optical, photoelectric gauge, and semiconductor strain gauges. Right? Semiconductor strain gauges are presently very popular because of their very small size. Right? And they can be sticked around using epoxy resin to any of the design structures, right? So unbonded strain gauge and so on. Part of it we have already covered. So let us now move on to procedure. Okay, so this is the strain gauge simulator. So what we need to do is that to study the working principle of the strain gauge using strain gauge simulator. So first we select the material of the strain gauge from the available drop-down menu. Select the value of input voltage and select the strain gauge. Do we have the video available? Let us see the video first so that it is
visible to us. But before we do that, let me see the settings that Mohsin had taught me some time back. While we are sharing it, we have to take care of the selection. So let me share it again. Include computer sound. Okay, and hopefully this should work. Let me put it on. And let me share accordingly. Okay, fine. So have a look.
The next experiment is how to characterize a strain gauge sensor.
I hope it is audible. Could someone just confirm if it is audible to you all or not? I have put it off just now.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine. Let me put it on then again.
The aim, theory, procedure, review questions, references are already there with the experiment. You are advised to read carefully the theory first, then procedure, and then perform the experiment. Go to simulator. Now you can click here for simulator. Now this experiment, you will have a lot of configurable parameters. This experiment is of two levels. In level one, you are selecting what will be the material of construction of strain gauge. For example, I've selected copper as a material. Input voltage for excitation, 5 volt DC. The resistance which I've selected for strain gauge is suppose 120 ohm. And the configuration, there are four types of configurations you can have. One is called as quarter bridge, half bridge in adjacent arms, half bridge in opposite arms, and full bridge. Now in this case, if I select full bridge, you will find that these strain gauges, all the strain gauges and all the arms of this bridge are active. Instead of that, if I select half bridge opposite, you will find strain gauges are kept in opposite arm and the fixed resistors are kept in the opposite arms. Instead of that, if you go for half bridge in adjacent arms, you will find the configuration would be like this. And then if you go for quarter bridge, only one strain gauge would be available and would be connected in the bridge. Now, each configuration has got distinct advantages and limitations. You are advised to read the theory carefully. And as per your application, select whether the configuration should be quarter bridge or full bridge. Then select the gauge factor. Gauge factor is varying from 0.9 to 8.5. Suppose I have selected 0.9 as gauge factor and then configure the entire system. Once you have configured it, you will say yes. Indicates that the material of construction is copper, input voltage is 5 volt, resistance is 120, gauge factor is 0.9, and quarter bridge you have selected. Now, you will have to keep on adding weights on this cantilever beam, and the strain gauge is installed at this point where the maximum sensitivity would be there. So you will select how much weight you want to add. For example, if you have added 0.5 kg, the RG value or the gauge value resistance of the gauge would be 120.0136. Then calculate output voltage in millivolt by using this formula. So this formula is dr equal to gauge factor into dl by l into r, where you have already given all the details about the applied weight, distance from load point to SG center, width of cantilever, thickness of cantilever. All this are given. Please read it carefully. Use this table for Young's modulus, linear expansion coefficient of strain gauge. After solving this, enter value of output in millivolt. You will have to do this exercise 3 times. Now change the position, change the weight. Suppose I have added 4 kgs and I'll calculate what will be the output of strain gauge in millivolt if you have added here a weight of 4 kg. Submit it. Correct. Then change this to suppose 8 kgs. And then submit. After 3 readings, the plot will be available. Now this is the characterization curve of weight versus output in millivolt if you have connected strain gauge in a specific configuration as mentioned before. Now you will find that level 2 is now on. Now level 2, if you click on to level 2, this is used to demonstrate the effect of position of weight on the output of the strain gauge bridge. Now select here the position in centimeter. For example, if I select position in 16 centimeter or if I select 10 centimeter, this is 16 centimeter and this is 10 centimeter. The last weight we added was 8 kg. So this weight would remain as 8 kg. The output will become 1.41. You go on changing these values, you will find the output weight will go on changing. So if you add here 9, output voltage in millivolt will become 1.27. You can plot a graph. Now the graph will indicate that according to position, how the output of the strain gauge is changing without changing the weight. And because of this, now you are eligible to go for level 3. Here, load is connected maximum away from strain gauge, that is 16 centimeter, and the output is 2.26 millivolt. In all other cases, you will find that the output was reducing. Naturally, the bending moment is less. Now go to level 3. Now level 3 is identifying what will be the effect of temperature on the performance of strain gauge. The RG value or the resistance of the gauge which we have considered as 120.2169 is at 20 degrees Celsius. Now if I expose this to 30 degrees Celsius, what will happen? The new value of RG will become 115.28. Now if you will go on changing this temperature, the new value will go on decreasing. So in other words, if the temperature is 10 degrees, 120 becomes 124.97. So in other words, as you are increasing the temperature, resistance will go on decreasing. So here for 40, you get some value, but if you expose it to 10 degrees, you get higher value. Now, this is how 3 stages of experiment can be proved. One is the bridge configuration. It's called as level 1. Level 2 is position of the weight. And level 3 means what will be the effect of temperature on the performance of the strain gauge. Now, this calculation will clearly reveal that there would be effect of change in temperature on the performance of the strain gauge. Hence, if you are measuring strain, temperature compensation is mandatory.
Okay, do you want me to play that again? I think it was, you know, it is a long one. Or else there is another option. The link I can share with you here itself in the chat window, and I suggest you do it there at your place. We are only 4 people. All of you can do this experiment at your end and see the results on your own, right? When you try to do it at your end, you will be able to go through the procedure and the video over and over again. Will that be fine with all of you? Are you comfortable? You can just raise your hand if you are comfortable doing this, because there are 3 levels to this experiment. If I share the link with you here in the conversation, you can, yes, I have the option. Let me see the link. Okay, should could you please go to this link and try to work this experiment on your own? That way you will be more confident of doing it, because if I work it, I'll be able to do it comfortably. You will not be able to do it confidently. You can always see the video. You can always go through the procedure steps again and then do it. But I suggest you do it. It will take us a little bit more time. We generally leave you by 1 hour, but I believe if we are doing it, let us do it properly. What do you say? Are you people ready to do it? Are you comfortable doing it? If yes, just raise your hand so that I am convinced that I am doing the right thing. No, not interested in doing it. Uske liye to hand raise karo na, that you are not interested in doing it. Then I'll I'll find out some other method, because it is a longer procedure. I wanted you to do it. I hope I'm audible. Yes, I think yes, I'm audible. But aap logo ki taraf se koi response nahi hai. I'm waiting for it. Please let me know.
Ma'am, we'll do it by ourselves.
Okay, so you will do it. What about the rest of the three people? Do it right now, huh? Aisa nahi
ki baat bhi karein. I'll do it.
Okay, fine. Theek hai. Two people are saying yes, so let us wait for you. You do it at your own end and then let me know. First, let me know whether you are able to open the link or not.
Ma'am, we are able to open the link.
Okay, fine. Thank you for that. Number 17 and 23, are you trying as well? Number 17 and you trying?
Ma'am,
could you please repeat?
Ma'am, I got the plot for first level.
Okay, fine.
also share if they are getting certain answers, certain plot level 1, level 2, as in how you clear it. Okay, you can see the plot that I have shown you on the
shared screen. Those who are having difficulty, please remember you'll have to use the formula to find out the value on your own, right? You'll have to calculate on your own, and then and only then you can actually see the result coming out like this. It is presently shared on the screen. I also did the same calculation that I've asked you people to do. I have taken 2 kg, 4 kg and 10 kg as my references, and these are the plots that I am getting, right? Please let me know if someone is not able to get it. We can share the video again. Even you have access to the link, so you can see it on your own also. In case of any query, please feel free to ask. Level 1 output. Can you all share whether you are getting this thing or not? You can simply raise your hand if you are getting it up to level 1. Okay, fine. Fine, 2 people are getting it. 3. Remember, you have to calculate the values. You'll have to use the formula and calculate the values to get it up till here, right? And I have been doing it all the steps. Thank you, number 23 and 18 also. So all of us are getting it, right? I have been doing the steps right in front of you in order to show you this results, right? So that is level 1. Now let's go to level 2. We are continuing with the same configuration, right? We can select the position of the weight. So let us do that. Let us, okay, so I'll have to select it from here. Let's say 10, so somewhere like this, and okay, so I have to drag it minimum 3 times so that I can show three different values. Okay, somewhere like here. So I have a plot of level 2. It has changed. You could have seen the last time it was. Yeah, when you are doing this thing, you can keep a copy of this graph, right? When you are writing your manual, you will be needing a copy of this graph. So the earlier one, if possible, please save it. There is an option. Is there an option to save it? I can straight away save it by taking a screenshot. Okay. So this is level 2 output. And similarly for level 3. Okay. So the effect of the temperature. So presently, whatever settings you had done initially, they are all available over here, right? It's available in configuration. The RG value is also available. Now we can go for change of temperature. So let us say it is 25 degrees centigrade. New value of the gauge resistance is 117.85. At 20 degrees centigrade, it was 120.6026, right? So if we go through the formula, we have delta T now coming into the picture. Okay. So relevant all formulas are given over here. We can make this plot. So there is one at 25. Let us say one more at 15. And check this values. And the one is at 30. So I have selected three values. I can now plot it. And you can have a look at the plot. So as and how your temperature increases, the value of RG in ohm decreases. Fine. So this was our practical for today. I hope you all enjoyed it. And since you did it on your own, I hope it was more enjoyable. Kindly let me know if you have any query by the time I take your attendance. taken your attendance, and if you do not have any queries, may we now end the session. Is that fine with everyone? Or you want to continue for the next 20 minutes as well? Please raise your hand if you are fine with ending the session right now. Okay, fine. Okay, dear. Thank you, everyone. I hope you had a nice study time. After a long time, we happened to sit together and study. And number 23, I hope, is equally comfortable with ending the session. So wish you a nice, happy time. We'll be meeting next week again. Take care, all of you. 23, you want to say something? You have unmuted yourself. Okay, fine, everybody. Goodbye. Take care. Bye-bye.